Dear student, the topic of this video is adrenal gland. At the end of this session, the student will be able to correlate the histological specialization of different layers of adrenal cortex and medulla for secretion of specific hormones, list the hormones secreted from different layers of adrenal cortex, give the steps of synthesis of different adrenocortical hormones, understand the deficiency of adrenocortical enzymes causing a specific dysfunction or syndrome. We'll be able to describe the regulation of secretion, mechanism of action, and functions of glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid, appreciate the physiological importance of cortisol and interindications and contraindications of cortisol use in clinical medicine, understand the physiological basis of dysfunction caused by excess or deficiency of glucocorticoids and mineralocorticoids, outline the functions and dysfunctions of adrenal sex steroid. Functional anatomy. The human adrenal glands each weighs only 4 gram. It is located above the upper pole of each kidney in the retroperitoneal space. Each gland is composed of two major parts, the adrenal medulla, so this part is the adrenal medulla, and the adrenal cortex. So this is adrenal cortex. The adrenal cortex in adult consists of three distinctive zones. One is the outermost zone, just below the capsule is the zona glandulosa, then zona fasciculata and zona reticularis. So zona glomerulosa, so this part, zona glomerulosa is a thin layer of cells that lies just underneath the capsule and it constitutes about 15% of the adrenal cortex. So zona glomerulosa, it consists of 15% of the adrenal cortex. These cells are small with a moderate number of lipid inclusions in the cytoplasm. The nuclei are smaller as compared to other two zones. Now zona fasciculata, we can see, so this up to this part is zona glomerulosa. So this much is the zona fasciculata. So we can say what are the layers? It is GFR. So from the kidney, we already know GFR is our glomerular filtration rate. So if you put this GFR mnemonic here, so you will well understand G means glomerulosa, F means fasciculata, R means reticularis. So if you move from above downwards, from a superficial structure to the deeper structure of adrenal cortex, the layers are GFR. Zona glomerulosa, that is 15%, and the hormone that is secreted from it, it is mineralocorticoid. It is not never G for G. Glomerulosa for glomerulocorticoid is not there. It is G for M. Glomerulosa secretes mineralocorticoid. So zona fasciculata, the next layer, the middle and the widest zone. So it constitutes about 75% of the adrenal cortex and secretes cortisol and corticosterone, that is your glucocorticoids. So glomerulosa secretes the mineralocorticoid, fasciculata secretes glucocorticoids, that is cortisol and corticosterone. In addition to that, small amounts of adrenal androgens and estrogens can also be secreted here. The next layer is zona reticularis, the inner zone of the cortex. It secretes the adrenal androgens. What are those? DHEA, that is dihydroepiandrosterone, and androstenedione, as well as small amounts of estrogen and some glucocorticoids can also be secreted from this area. Now the blood supply of this gland. So it is supplied by three arteries, that is superior suprarenal arteries, middle suprarenal artery and the inferior suprarenal artery. So superior suprarenal artery, it arises from the branch of inferior phrenic artery. So this is the inferior phrenic artery. We can see here, this one is the inferior phrenic artery. So superior mesenteric artery is a branch. The superior suprarenal artery is a branch of this inferior phrenic artery. So the second is the middle adrenal artery, which arises directly from the abdominal aorta. So this middle adrenal or the suprarenal artery. Then the inferior suprarenal artery, so this one, this inferior suprarenal artery is the branch of the renal artery on same side. So right in inferior suprarenal artery from right renal artery, and left inferior suprarenal artery, it arises from left renal artery. Regarding veins, right suprarenal veins, it directly drains into the inferior vena cava. Left suprarenal vein, it drains into the first into the inferior phrenic vein, then left renal vein, and then it goes to the inferior vena cava. So left one, it drains into the renal vein, right one directly goes to the inferior vena cava. Now regarding the development or fetal adrenal gland, so this we'll see that in the fetus, fetal adrenal gland, it begins developing at 3 to 4 weeks of gestation. So here we can see the adrenal gland at 5 month intrauterine age. At about 5 to 8 week of gestation, there is rapid enlargement of the adrenal gland, where the cells of the cortex differentiate to form the fetal zone and the outer layer called the definitive zone or the adult zone. So the cortex, you can see it is divided into two parts. So this is the fetal zone and this yellowish area is the adult zone or the definitive zone. This together forms the cortex. And the fetal cortex, it is around 75% at 5th month, and adult cortex is 20%. Okay. Now at the central portion, we have the very small adrenal medulla. And about this time, that is at this 5th to 8th month, okay, so about this time, sympathetic neural cells invade the primordium of adrenal cortex, and these cells differentiate into chromaffin cells, which are able to synthesize and store catecholamines. So at around this time, the primordium, within the primordium of adrenal cortex, the neural cells, sympathetic neural cells, will invade, and they will ultimately form the chromaffin cells, which in the adult form we will see that they are mostly concentrated in the adrenal medulla. Now at the time of birth, so what will happen at the time of birth, then the adrenal gland will have adrenal cortex consisting the fetal cortex and the adult cortex and the adrenal medulla. What is the percentage? So at the time of birth, the fetal cortex, it remains 80%, and outer layer or the adult cortex remains 20%. But within first month, so here we have a next picture, that is a newborn baby. After 1 month, we can see that the fetal cortex, it undergoes a reduction in size to about 50% of its size at birth. So there is rapid reduction of the size of the fetal cortex. And at the same time, the medulla proportionately increases in size. So, and it is the adult form where we cannot find any fetal cortex present here. And the adrenal cortex, it is further divided into three zones, and the central part is your medulla. And the feedback regulation of ACTH by cortisol, it is established by the 8 to 10 weeks of gestation, 8th to 10th weeks of gestation. So fetal adrenal gland begins to develop 3 to 4 weeks, and this adrenal cortex versus medulla and cortex containing fetal cortex and adult cortex, it starts around 5th to 8th week of gestation. And this regulation by ACTH, it is also established by 8 to 10th weeks of gestation. So within 8 to 10th means within first trimester, there will be well developed fetal adrenal gland. and these gland is very much necessary. In my videos in the reproductive system, you know what is, you have seen what is fetoplacental unit. So we can see here, so this is a fetoplacental unit, that is the interaction between the fetus and mother during synthesis of steroid hormone. It is called the fetoplacental unit. So the mother placenta and the fetus, they act as a unit in order to synthesize the steroid hormone. So we'll see, from the maternal blood, cholesterol will enter into the placenta. They will form pregnenolone. Pregnenolone will move to the fetus, and in the fetus, this pregnenolone will go to the adrenal cortex. From there will be synthesis of dihydroepiandrosterone and predominantly 16-hydroxydihydroepiandrosterone. But fetus cannot convert them to the estrogen. So they will again come into the placenta. Well, the placenta will convert them to estradiol and estriol. So this estriol is a major component, as the predominant androgen is 16-hydroxydihydroepiandrosterone, and this estriol will be released into the circulation. And urinary estriol level, maternal urinary estriol level, it is clinically used as an index of the health of the fetus, whether the fetal adrenal gland is working properly, fetoplacental unit is working properly. That can be seen, that can be estimated by measuring this estriol level in the maternal urine. So this fetal adrenal gland is a part of this fetoplacental unit. This is one importance. Another importance is, we know that at around 35 week of gestational age, what happens? The placenta will start synthesizing placental CRH. So at around 35th week of gestation, prior delivery of the baby, the placenta will start secreting placental CRH, corticotropin releasing hormone. This is not the pituitary CRH, this is the placental CRH. It will enter into the fetal circulation, that will induce the fetal adrenal gland to synthesize the steroids. For example, the steroids, the cortisol and the dihydroepiandrosterone. This cortisol will be utilized for the maturation of the fetal lung. That is very much essential for delivery. After delivery, the fetus will start taking breath. The respiration will start. So fetal lung maturation is very important. That will be done by cortisol. And this dihydroepiandrosterone will come to the placenta again, and the placenta will generate the estriol and estradiol. This estriol and estradiol are responsible for creating increased number of receptors for oxytocin and prostaglandins into the uterus. Into the uterine wall, more number of oxytocin and prostaglandin receptors will be generated. Increased gap junctions within the myometrium will be generated. Why they are needed? Because at the onset of labor, we will see, although the oxytocin level is less, due to presence of higher number of oxytocin receptor, they will generate uterine contraction. So the onset of labor, that is also facilitated by the fetal adrenal gland, and fetal adrenal gland will be induced by the placental CRH. So fetal adrenal gland has two clinical importance. One is, it will be the part of fetoplacental unit, and second, it will induced by the placental CRH, it will start secreting certain hormones that will help in the onset of labor. Now we all know that any hormone, we have to discuss them under 6 or 7 headings. First is the chemistry of the hormone, how they are synthesized, when they are released into the circulation, how they are released, that is secretion, when they will go to the target organ, so that is the mechanism of action. As a result of this mechanism, what will be the physiological functions, when the function is end, it is finished, so how they will be metabolized and excreted from the body, and diseases associated with hyper and hyposecretion of hormone. So this is true for all the hormones. So all these headings we will study now for the adrenal cortical hormones. So first is the steps of synthesis of these hormones. So before going to that, we must know the chemistry of these hormones. So the hormones of the adrenal cortex are derivatives of cholesterol. Like the cholesterol, vitamin D and ovarian and testicular steroids, they contain the CPP ring. So this is CPP ring, that is cyclopentanopyrhydrophenanthrene nucleus. So they will have this CPP nucleus. Now gonadal and adrenocortical steroids, they are of three types. According to the number of carbons, we can divide them into three types. One is C21 steroids. So first we can see, so this is the C21 steroids. So they will have a two carbon side chain at the position 17. So this is your position 17. From this we can see this area is position 17. So at position 17, they will have a two carbon side chain. Okay. So they are C21 carbons. What are the example of this? We know the progesterone is C21 steroid. And corticosteroids, all the adrenocortical hormones, they are C21 steroids. Okay. Now, so one type is C21 steroid. Another type is the C19 steroids. C19 steroids, they have a keto or hydroxyl group at 17th position. So at the 17th position, they will have one keto or hydroxyl group. So they are the C19 carbons. Adrenal androgens, okay, so and also the testosterone, there are the example of C19 steroids. Another type is C18 steroids. C18, so C18 steroids, they have at 17 position 17 keto or hydroxyl group, plus there is no angular methyl group attached to position number 10. So which one is the position number 10? So this part is your position number 10. So these C18, they have one keto group or hydroxyl group attached at C17 position. At the C10 position, there is no angular methyl group attached to it. So we have C21, C19 and C18 types of steroids. Okay. And the examples we know, C19 steroids, they have the androgenic activity. C21 steroids, the examples are mineralocorticoids, glucocorticoids, as well as the progesterone. And C18 steroid is your estrogen. Now, these are the steps of synthesis. So, before going to that, we need to know another thing, that is Greek letter delta. It indicates a double bond, and the grooves that lie above the plane of each of the steroids rings are indicated by the Greek letter beta and a solid line OH and a solid line OH. So we can see here, so this solid line, it indicates the beta position, that is the grooves that lie above the plane of each of the steroid rings. So this is a beta position, and this is indicated by a solid line. Whereas those that lie below the plane are indicated by alpha, and it is said alpha, and they are indicated by the dashed line. So beta position, it is indicated by solid line, and the alpha position below the plane, it is indicated by dashed line. Okay. And in most of the naturally occurring steroid, you will see The 17 hydroxy groups are in alpha configuration. 17 hydroxy group is in the alpha configuration, whereas 3, 11 and 21 hydroxy group are in the beta configuration. So 17 hydroxy, it is in the alpha configuration, and 3, 11 and 21 hydroxy, they are in the beta configuration. Beta indicated by solid line, alpha indicated by dashed line. Now, what are the major steroid hormones? We can see here from this graph. So, innumerable steroids have been isolated from adrenal tissue. But the only steroids normally secreted in physiologically significant amounts, they are the mineralocorticoid. For example, it is the aldosterone. And there may be glucocorticoids like cortisol and corticosterone. Cortisol and corticosterone. And there may be dihydroepiandrosterone. This is the androgen. Another before synthesis of aldosterone, there is an intermediate metabolite, that is a deoxycorticosterone. So it has got mineralocorticoid activity. Regarding the concentration, we can see that the cortisol, its concentration is around this much, free and bound form, and average amount secreted milligram per 24 hour is around 10. Whereas the maximum quantity we'll find in dihydroepiandrosterone, and this corticosterone, aldosterone, their amount is very less. Okay. Now come to the steps of synthesis. So we can see here the major path of synthesis of adrenocortical hormones. The precursor of all steroids is cholesterol. Now this, what is the source of this cholesterol? So precursor is, it is always cholesterol. Okay, so from where this cholesterol comes? So this cholesterol, we can see here, either it is synthesized by the cell, but most of it is taken off from LDL in the circulation. That is the low density lipoprotein, LDL in the circulation, they will be taken up, and this is the LDL cholesterol. Okay. Now the cholesterol is esterified and stored in the lipid droplet. So within the lipid droplet, this cholesterol is esterified. So cholesterol ester is there. Okay. So we need one enzyme, that is cholesterol ester hydrolase, that will catalyze and form the free cholesterol in the lipid droplets. So cholesterol ester hydrolase, this enzyme is required. Okay. And in the mitochondria, it is converted to pregnenolone in a reaction catalyzed by an enzyme known as cholesterol desmolase or side chain cleavage enzyme. Okay. So these cholesterol, this free cholesterol, then it will move to the mitochondria. Within the mitochondria, so we can see that this is a free cholesterol. This free cholesterol, now it is moving into the mitochondria. So some enzymes within the mitochondria, they will convert this cholesterol to pregnenolone. Now this pregnenolone, okay, so the intermediates, they will, from the mitochondria, now they will shift to the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, and some intermediates will be formed within the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. From it will again enter into the mitochondria, and they will final formation of steroid, cortisol, corticosterone or aldosterone will take place within the mitochondria. Then they will enter into the cell and it will be released into the circulation. Okay. So first it will start with the cholesterol ester, then it will form the free cholesterol which will move into the mitochondria. From the mitochondria, up to certain intermediate metabolites will be formed, they will move to the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, and then few intermediate metabolites will be formed and they will return back to the mitochondria and the final hormones will be secreted here, synthesized here. They will be released into the cell, remain stored, and whenever needed, they will be secreted or excreted into the circulation. So now, the steps that is happening in mitochondria as well as in the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So we can see that here, see here, the cholesterol, it will be converted to pregnenolone, okay, with the help of enzyme cholesterol desmolase that is present within the mitochondria. This enzyme, like most of the enzymes involved in the steroid biosynthesis, is a member of cytochrome P450 superfamily and is also known as P450-SCC or CYP11A1. Okay, so most of these enzymes you will see here, they are the family, they belongs to the family of cytochrome P450 superfamily. Okay, now when the pregnenolone is formed within the mitochondria, pregnenolone moves into the smooth endoplasmic reticulum where some of it is dehydrogenated to form the progesterone in a reaction catalyzed by 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase. So this is your 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase. Where it is located? Not in the mitochondria, in the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. And one importance of this enzyme is that it does not belong to P cytochrome P450 superfamily. All other enzymes, they are included into the cytochrome P450 superfamily except this 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase. Okay, now it also catalyzes the conversion of 17-alpha-hydroxypregnenolone to 17-alpha-hydroxyprogesterone. Okay. So it also catalyzes, so this 3-beta-hydroxysteroid, so this enzyme, it is true for this also. So it will convert 17-hydroxypregnenolone to 17-hydroxyprogesterone and also dehydroepiandrosterone to androstenedione. So dehydroepiandrosterone to androstenedione. So this 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, it will act in this line. It will convert pregnenolone to progesterone, 17-hydroxypregnenolone to 17-hydroxyprogesterone, dehydroepiandrosterone to androstenedione. But they will happen in 3 different layers. If we see into the end product of this layer is aldosterone, that is the mineralocorticoid. So this reaction is taking place into zona glomerulosa. And here in this vertical line, the end product is cortisol. So these chain of reactions are taking place into zona fasciculata. Here it is, the end product is adrenal androgen. So it is happening into the zona reticularis. So some enzymes are common. So these enzyme 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase is present in all these layers, and in zona glomerulosa, it is converting the pregnenolone to progesterone. In fasciculata, 17-hydroxypregnenolone to 17-hydroxyprogesterone. In reticularis, to dehydroepiandrosterone to androstenedione. And it is happening where? At the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay. Now, after that, what will happen? This 17-alpha-hydroxypregnenolone and progesterone, they are formed from pregnenolone and progesterone respectively by the action of 17-alpha-hydroxylase. Okay. Now what happens? The formation after the formation of this pregnenolone or 17-hydroxypregnenolone, what will happen? So these pregnenolone and progesterone will be converted to 11-deoxycorticosterone or 11-deoxycortisol with the help of the enzyme 21-beta-hydroxylase. And where this enzyme is located, 21-beta-hydroxylase, it is again located into the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay. So 21 beta hydroxylase is enzyme will act in the three arms, in these two arms. So they will convert the progesterone to 11 deoxycorticosterone in zona glomerulosa and 17 hydroxy progesterone to 11 deoxycortisol in zona fasciculata. So up to this, so the formation of pregnenolone, this is it was happening within the mitochondria. So mitochondria, from then up to 11 deoxycorticosterone, this will happen into the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So we are getting 11 deoxycorticosterone and 11 deoxycortisol. These two intermediates, they will move back to mitochondria. And within the mitochondria, we have another enzyme, 11 beta hydroxylase. So where is the location of this 11 beta? We can see here within the mitochondria. So first is your cholesterol, the small s, that will convert the cholesterol to pregnenolone in the mitochondria. Now this pregnenolone will be converted to 3 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, and it will form progesterone or 17 hydroxy progesterone, depending upon the which layer we are talking about. And this 3 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, which is located into the ACR or smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Then this pregnenolone or 17 hydroxy progesterone or 17 hydroxy progesterone, they will be converted into 11 deoxycorticosterone and 11 deoxycortisol respectively with the help of the enzyme 21 beta hydroxylase, that is located again in the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. After formation of this, both 11 deoxycortisol and corticosterone, they will move back into the mitochondria and they will be acted upon by 11 beta hydroxylase and they will form the corticosterone and the cortisol. Okay, now in the zona glomerulosa, that secretes the aldosterone. In the zona glomerulosa, there is another very important enzyme located, that is aldosterone synthase. It is also P450, 95% identical to 11 beta hydroxylase. Okay, and this aldosterone synthase is normally found only and only in the zona glomerulosa. Okay, so that's why zona glomerulosa will ultimately end in the formation of aldosterone, not the other layers. In addition to that, zona glomerulosa also lacks the 17 alpha hydroxylase enzyme. So as 17 alpha hydroxylase is deficient, so there is no formation of these vertical chain hormones. This is totally absent in zona glomerulosa. So zona glomerulosa is meant for only and only for synthesis of aldosterone, because this enzyme is only located here and it is lack this 17 alpha hydroxylase. So we can say that, so zona glomerulosa, fasciculata and reticularis, one will synthesize aldosterone, another will cortisol, another will androgens. Okay, so up to certain level it will happen in the mitochondria, then it will go to the ACR, then again it will come back to the mitochondria, and ultimately the final product will be generated. So this is in a nutshell another way of describing the steps of synthesis. Now zona glomerulosa, we want to focus here. We know the chemistry of the steroid hormones, all the three layer hormones, we know their chemistry. Set C21, C19 or like this, like, okay, we know the steps of synthesis. Now we want to focus on the zona glomerulosa, that is on the aldosterone, how they are secreted, how they are metabolized, what are their target organs, what are their mechanism of action, what are their physiological functions. Aldosterone is a major mineralocorticoid, we know. So aldosterone is synthesized with the zona glomerulosa. We know the steps of synthesis. Now how this synthesis is regulated? Aldosterone secretion synthesis, it is regulated mainly by three important stimuli. ACTH, we can see here, So this is ACTH. It is acting at different enzymes, acting on different enzymes. Second factor is angiotensin 2. This angiotensin 2 we can see here also. And the third factor is plasma potassium concentration. Now, as with many other naturally occurring substances, the activity of adrenocortical steroids can be increased by altering their structure. Now, number of synthetic steroids are available. We can see from this list that we have some naturally occurring steroids in addition to some synthetic steroids are also available. The relative glucocorticoid and mineralocorticoid potencies of the natural steroids are compared here. We can see that the maximum mineralocorticoid activity it is present in the aldosterone. Okay. And deoxycorticosteroid, it also has some mineralocorticoid activity. So this deoxycorticosterone. Okay. Although it is not the aldosterone or the actual mineralocorticoid, but this deoxycorticosterone also has some mineralocorticoid activity. And if we see the glucocorticoids, that is the cortisol, okay, cortisol and the corticosterone, we can see cortisol have equal amount of glucocorticoid and mineralocorticoid activity, okay, and corticosterone has greater amount of mineralocorticoid activity. So glucocorticoids also have activities like the mineralocorticoid. But why the aldosterone is denoted as mineralocorticoid and the glucocorticoids are not doing the mineralocorticoids activity, that we'll discuss later. Okay. From this chart, it is also we can see that 9-alpha fluorocortisol, prednisolone and dexamethasone, these synthetic steroids, they also have some steroid-like activities. We can see prednisolone has higher glucocorticoid activities, 9-alpha fluorocortisol, it has higher mineralocorticoid activity. The potency of dexamethasone is due to its high affinity for glucocorticoid receptors and its long half-life. And prednisolone also has a long half-life. So aldosterone synthesis and secretion, we know it is regulated by three important stimuli, ACTH, as angiotensin 2 and plasma potassium. So first come to ACTH. Now ACTH, cells of zona glomerulosa of adrenal cortex have ACTH receptors. Now ACTH binds to high affinity receptors on the plasma membrane. Okay, so this is the ACTH receptor on the plasma membrane of adrenal cortex. This activates the adenyl cyclase via GS, G stimulatory peptide. So it is a G protein coupled receptor. So it is coupled with GS. Then there will be, it activates the adenyl cyclase, and intracellularly there will be formation of CAMP. So there will be prompt increase in the formation of CAMP. Okay, and which in turn it will promote the synthesis of proton kinase A, and this will ultimately enhance the activity of the cholesterol ester hydrolase enzyme. So this step will be enhanced or facilitated. Now one important point is there, this increase in the synthesis and secretion of aldosterone by ACTH. Okay, so this is transient. This effect is transient. Okay, this is temporary. Now, aldosterone secretion declines even if ACTH secretion is elevated. Okay, so after certain period, initially this ACTH will enhance the formation of pregnenolone and its derivative, and there will be enhanced secretion of steroid, but this effect is transient. After certain period, if the ACTH level is high for a longer duration, you will see that in spite of high level of ACTH, the aldosterone output declines in 1 or 2 days. Okay, on the other hand, the output of mineralocorticoid deoxycortisone, it remains elevated. Now the decline in aldosterone output is partly due to decreased renin secretion secondary to hypervolemia. So aldosterone will do something that will cause, it's when we see the functions of aldosterone, we'll see that it will enhance or increase the blood volume. This hypervolemia will decrease renin secretion, and due to this there will be fall in the aldosterone level, and the increase in ACTH level will not be able to stimulate the synthesis of aldosterone. And it is seen that it is possible that some other factor also decreases the conversion of corticosterone to aldosterone. So after hypophysectomy, so if the pituitary is removed, the basal rate of aldosterone secretion is normal. So we can say that from here that ACTH, definitely it is a stimulator, but in absence of ACTH2, the mineralocorticoid level, aldosterone level, can be maintained at the basal rate. Okay. Now we can say another thing is that, now suppose a person is having a high aldosterone level. If we treat the person with glucocorticoid, can it cause the negative feedback and suppress the activity of aldosterone? Okay, we know that almost of all these hormones, they act via some feedback pathway. In this case, it will be hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal axis. And if we can say the from the target adrenal hormone level is increased, so that will give a negative feedback. So the synthesis of adrenal hormone will be reduced. So instead of aldosterone, if cortisol level is increased, can it give a negative feedback? Normally, it does not. However, an interesting recently described syndrome is there, that is known as GRA, glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism. What happens here? This is an autosomal dominant disorder where there is increase in aldosterone secretion produced by ACTH is no longer transient. So the activity of ACTH, we are talking about it, it is transient. Okay, but here in GRA, glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism, the secretion of aldosterone and its regulation by ACTH, it is not transient. The hypersecretion of aldosterone and the accompanying hypertension, that's why, are remedied when ACTH secretion is suppressed. So by any means we can suppress ACTH, because it is, ACTH is also stimulating cortisol. So if we reduce, if we give cortisol, so that will give a negative feedback. Okay. So the hypersecretion of aldosterone and the accompanying hypertension can be reduced, can be remedied when ACTH secretion is suppressed by administering glucocorticoid. So mineralocorticoid is excess. So its amount is suppressed by suppressing ACTH, and this suppression is done by giving glucocorticoid. Okay, that's why it is known as glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism. And the genes encoding aldosterone synthase and 11 beta hydroxylase are 95% identical and are close together on chromosome number 8. In the individuals with GRA, there is unequal crossing over, so that the 5' regulatory region of 11 beta hydroxylase gene is fused to the coding region of aldosterone synthase gene. The product of this hybrid gene is ACTH sensitive aldosterone synthase. So in GRA or glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism, there will be hypersecretion of aldosterone due to some genetic defect, and due to genetic defect is due to some genetic mutation of 11 beta hydroxylase or aldosterone synthase enzyme. These aldosterone synthase enzyme is ACTH sensitive, not temporarily sensitive, permanently sensitive. That's why the suppression of ACTH can cause reduction in the aldosterone level, and this is known as glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism. So from this picture we can see here that this is how the ACTH is coming and it is stimulating the aldosterone. Now in addition to ACTH, we know the angiotensin 2 has got also positive effect in the synthesis of aldosterone. So these are the three factors. One is the ACTH, another is the adrenin-angiotensin cascade system, another is the potassium level, plasma potassium level. So ACTH part is discussed. Now the renin-angiotensin axis. So we know that so renin is will be secreted from the liver. It will convert the renin will be secreted from the juxtaglomerular apparatus, and it will convert the angiotensinogen that is secreted from liver into angiotensin 1. Now this angiotensin 1 will be converted to angiotensin 2 with the help of angiotensin converting enzyme that is released from the pulmonary capillaries. Okay, now angiotensin 2, this angiotensin 2, this is an important stimulator of aldosterone synthesis. Okay, and how it acts. Now angiotensin 2, it binds with angiotensin T1 receptor. So it will bind with the AT1 receptors in the zona glomerulosa, and this is also a G protein coupled receptor. So it will activate intracellular phospholipase C, and ultimately it will result in increase in protein kinase C. Okay, so the protein kinase C fosters the conversion of cholesterol to pregnenolone and facilitates the action of aldosterone synthase, resulting in increased secretion of aldosterone. So angiotensin 2 acts in two areas. One, it helps in the conversion of cholesterol to pregnenolone and also facilitates the action of aldosterone synthase, and ultimately aldosterone synthesis will be enhanced and it will bind with specific receptor angiotensin 1 or AT1 receptor. It will bind with the AT1 receptor. So now comes the part of the intracellular potassium. Okay, it is seen that increased plasma potassium level, that is increase in the ECF or extracellular fluid potassium level, it stimulates the aldosterone. We can see here that if the plasma potassium level it is increased, so it will stimulate the aldosterone level. And rise in extracellular fluid potassium actually activates voltage gated calcium channels that increases intracellular calcium. So we can see the secondary intracellular modulators in case of potassium, it is calcium, okay, via voltage gated calcium channel. For ACTH, it is cyclic AMP and protein kinase A. For angiotensin 2, it is diacyl glycerol and protein kinase C. For potassium, it is intracellular calcium. Increased cytosolic calcium increases aldosterone synthesis and secretion. Now aldosterone in turn promotes excretion of potassium. So why aldosterone is called when plasma ECF is high? Because aldosterone will do something with this potassium. Aldosterone actually promotes the excretion of potassium. Okay, so aldosterone is a natural regulator of potassium level in the extracellular fluid. And acute decrease in plasma sodium also stimulates the aldosterone synthesis and secretion. So this is about the regulation of aldosterone. Another important point we can say here, aldosterone can also be regulated by some diurnal variations as well. Now, how aldosterone synthesis is modulated by diurnal variation? In normal individuals, their plasma aldosterone concentrations increase during the portion of the day that the individual is carrying on activities in the upright posture. This increase is due to a decrease in the rate of removal of aldosterone from the circulation by the liver and an increase in aldosterone secretion due to postural increase in renin secretion. Individuals who are confined to bed show a circadian rhythm of aldosterone and renin secretion with the highest value in the early morning before awakening. So in addition to this circadian rhythm, so atrial natriuretic peptide which inhibits the renin secretion and decreases the responsiveness of the zona globulosa to angiotensin 2, it also affects the aldosterone level. So atrial natriuretic peptide, how it is affecting aldosterone secretion, we will see when we will discuss the aldosterone escape. Now from this picture we can see in the further details of renin, angiotensin and aldosterone axis. We can see here renin is secreted from the juxtaglomerular cells that surrounded the renal afferent arterioles as they entered the glomeruli. And aldosterone secretion is regulated via the renin-angiotensin system in a feedback manner. So a drop in extracellular fluid volume. So a drop in extracellular fluid volume. So one factor is extracellular fluid volume. So a drop in extracellular fluid volume or intra-arterial vascular volume leads to a reflex increase in renal nerve discharge and decreases renal arterial pressure. So if extracellular fluid volume is less, obviously renal arterial pressure will be less. So both changes increase renin secretion. Okay. So one, that is drop in extracellular fluid volume, and there will be and there decrease in renal arterial pressure. Okay, so here it is, this dashed line is showing the inhibition. So increased renal arterial pressure and decreased discharge of the renal nerve and increased extracellular fluid volume will cause the opposite effect, that is decrease in the renin secretion. Whereas a sudden drop in extracellular fluid volume, sudden drop in renal arterial mean pressure and increase in the renal nerve discharge will enhance the secretion of renin. Okay, and we know that this renin will enhance the conversion of angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1, and angiotensin 2 will be formed by the action of this and aldosterone will be synthesized because angiotensin 2 will bind with this AT1 receptor and enhance the secretion. Now aldosterone will cause the sodium and water retention. How it will cause that we'll see in the mechanism of action. So in this chart it is clear that some stressful activity, for example the hemorrhage will stimulate. Hemorrhage means loss of blood. There is sudden drop in extracellular fluid volume. There will be drop in intra-arterial vascular volume. Okay. So they will stimulate ACTH as well as renin secretion. Okay. Because why the ACTH is stimulated? Because all these conditions are related to stress. So not only hemorrhage, surgery, anxiety, physical trauma, all of them, they will cause stress. And any kind of stress will enhance the corticotropin releasing hormone, and that will also enhance the ACTH. Okay. So in these conditions, stressful conditions, not only isolatedly the aldosterone is increased, so in addition to aldosterone, glucocorticoid levels will also be increased. Okay. Now, an isolated increase in the aldosterone, you can see it will happen in high potassium level and low sodium level. High potassium intake and low sodium intake. Which one is most important? High potassium or low sodium? It is seen that acute decline of sodium plasma sodium of 20 milliequivalent per liter, it stimulates aldosterone. So how much decline in sodium? 20 milliequivalent per liter decline in sodium will stimulate aldosterone synthesis. However, the plasma potassium level increase in only 1 milliequivalent per liter will stimulate aldosterone secretion. So which one is more powerful? Increase in potassium level is more powerful stimulus for the synthesis of aldosterone. So we can say that aldosterone synthesis, it is regulated by acetylcholine, which has this transient effect. It is affected by renin-angiotensin aldosterone system. It is also affected by plasma concentration of potassium as well as via the diurnal variation. Now aldosterone, how it is, when it is released into the circulation, now we will see that aldosterone is available both in free form and the bound form. And bound form is associated with plasma globulin. Free form is very less in amount and it is metabolized. Half-life of aldosterone is 15 to 20 minutes and it is metabolized in the liver and excreted in kidneys. Now, what about the functions of aldosterone? What are the physiological functions of aldosterone? So, physiological functions we will see, it is mostly the electrolyte and water balance. The main function of aldosterone is to increase sodium and water reabsorption and to promote potassium and H plus excretion. So, it is acting on the kidney, we can say, see here, and increase the reabsorption of sodium in renal tubular epithelial cells, sodium reabsorption, and increase secretion of potassium by the renal tubular epithelial cells. That's why acute rise in potassium and acute fall in sodium, in these two conditions aldosterone, it is secreted, because its function, it will try to enhance the sodium level and it will try to reduce the potassium. In addition to that, it will also increase the secretion of H plus ion in the intercalated cells of the cortical tubules. So it will increase the extracellular fluid volume as well as the arterial pressure. Okay. Now at which part of the renal tubule or kidney nephron it will help in the sodium reabsorption? For sodium reabsorption, aldosterone acts primarily on the P cells or the principal cells of the collecting duct and distal tubule of the kidney. So when we have, if you see the videos of tubular reabsorption, you will see that the 3% of sodium, okay, it remains within the, it enters into the collecting duct. Okay, remaining will be reabsorbed in the other portion of the renal tubule. We know that maximum in the proximal and some part in the ascending loop. Okay, so when the tubular fluid it is entering the collecting duct, it contains this 3% of the sodium, total sodium reabsorption. Okay, now aldosterone is responsible of this 3% reabsorption. Whether there is 3% of sodium will be reabsorbed or not, that will be determined by the aldosterone. If aldosterone is there, then that sodium will be reabsorbed. Now the question is how? Now this aldosterone, we know it is a steroid hormone. So its receptor is intracellular, that is a cytoplasmic. So it will bind with its receptor and the mineralocorticoid receptor complex will be formed. They will go to the nucleus and it will cause the transcription mRNA and form translation of so many proteins. And what are those proteins? These proteins are nothing, no one but the epithelial sodium channels. Okay, so it will enhance the number of epithelial sodium channels and more number of sodium channels will be attached at the luminal side of this tubular membrane. Okay, so it will also stimulate the sodium potassium ATPase pump activity. We know that if this pump is active, that intracellular sodium concentration will be less. So through this epithelial sodium channel, along the concentration gradient, this sodium can, along the concentration and electrical gradient, sodium can easily enter within the cell. Okay. It also stimulates enzymes of the Krebs cycles that facilitate ATP generation and provide energy for removal of sodium for interstitial fluid into the capillary. So from this interstitial fluid, this side is the interstitial fluid, from here into the capillary, the movement of sodium is also facilitated. Thus, aldosterone increases plasma sodium concentration and decreases potassium concentration. Now, what is aldosterone escape? So, we know that more amount of sodium and water, or salt and water reabsorption, means extracellular fluid volume expansion. So, when the aldosterone is synthesized, so salt and water is reabsorbed, ACF volume is expanded. So, after certain period, okay, so what will happen? You will see that increased extracellular fluid volume will increase the venous return to the heart, that causes the further distension of atria during their filling, and from this, the stretching of this atria, there will be release of some specific protein, that is atrial natriuretic peptide, that will be released from atrial myocytes. This atrial natriuretic peptide causes profound natriuresis and diuresis, and extracellular fluid volume, it returns back to normal. This is called the aldosterone escape phenomena, as kidney escapes from the effect of aldosterone. So initially aldosterone concentration is increased, extracellular fluid volume is expanded, but that has an upper limit. After certain physiological limit, there will be no further increase in the extracellular fluid volume. There will be profound natriuresis and diuresis facilitated by atrial natriuretic peptide, and extracellular fluid volume will return back to normal. This is known as aldosterone escape phenomena. This is specially, you will find it in case of primary hyperaldosteronism. So here we can see the mechanism, another point of mechanism of action of aldosterone. We can see here it will bind with its specific intracellular receptor, okay, and then the receptor complex, it will enter into the nucleus, and there will be transcription of mRNA. This increases the production of proteins that alter the cell function. Now, these aldosterone stimulated proteins, they have effects, rapid effect, which will increase the activity of epithelial sodium channels by increasing the insertion of these channels into the cell membrane from the cytoplasmic pool. And another is the slower effect, that is the increase in the synthesis of epithelial sodium. Now, among the genes activated by aldosterone is the gene for serum and glucocorticoid regulated kinase, that is this SGK, serum and glucocorticoid regulated kinase, a serine threonine protein kinase. The gene for SGK is an early response gene, and the early effect is already the pool that contains the epithelial sodium channel, they will be inserted on the luminal surface. Okay, and this SGK is an early response gene, and it enhances the epithelial sodium channels. Aldosterone also increases the mRNA for the three subunits that make up the epithelial sodium channels. The fact that SGK is activated by glucocorticoids as well as aldosterone is, okay, so this SGK, we have seen that glucocorticoid, cortisol and corticosterone, they also have the same amount of mineralocorticoid property, okay, But this SGK, that is activated by glucocorticoid as well as aldosterone. Okay, but it is not a problem because glucocorticoids will be inactivated at mineralocorticoid receptor sites. We know that the genes that are causing the epithelial sodium channel insertion, that can be activated by glucocorticoid as well as mineralocorticoid. So when there is cortisol excess, you can expect this salt and water reabsorption. Then why it is not happening? Because when they will go and bind with the mineralocorticoid receptor site, these glucocorticoids, okay, they will be inactivated. Okay, they will be inactivated. So this is the mechanism how it is enhancing the reabsorption of sodium from the principal cell. We can see here the principal cell. This is the mechanism. So in the luminal surface, we can see the epithelial sodium channel expression is increased and the basolateral membrane sodium potassium ATPase pump, its activity is increased. And this is the function at the intercalated cell, which deals with the potash H plus excretion and potassium reabsorption. So H plus secretion will be enhanced, potassium reabsorption will be enhanced. And these are the conditions we have already seen. They will increase the level of aldosterone. Now come to the question that we know that glucocorticoid, it also can stimulate this SGK genes and can activate then cause the epithelial sodium channel insertion. Then why the glucocorticoid is not doing that? Cortisol excess is not causing volume expansion. Okay, now the mineralocorticoid receptor, you will find they have affinity for the glucocorticoids too. So the cortisol excess, they will bind with the glucocorticoid receptor as well as the mineralocorticoid receptor and will do the glucocorticoid activity as well as mineralocorticoid activity. But it does not do so because of the presence of a specific enzyme in the kidneys and in other mineralocorticoid sensitive tissues. Okay, so we have a specialized enzyme. Okay, so we know that the target organs of mineralocorticoid is kidney. Okay, most important target organ is the kidney. So mineralocorticoid will go to the kidney and it will bind with its receptor there. So if the glucocorticoid goes to these areas and bind with the mineralocorticoid receptors too, because they have affinity, receptors have affinity for glucocorticoid, then there comes the activity of this specific enzyme. This enzyme is 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase type 1 and type 2. So in mineralocorticoid sensitive tissues, in the target organs of the mineralocorticoid, although the mineralocorticoid receptors are sensitive to glucocorticoid, okay, these enzymes, these 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase enzyme type 1 and 2, especially type 2, this leaves aldosterone untouched, but it converts cortisol to cortisone and corticosterone. Okay, and these corticosterone, they cannot bind to this mineralocorticoid receptor. So glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid, both are coming to the target organ kidney, to the tubule. Okay, they are trying to bind with the same mineralocorticoid receptor. So aldosterone will be able to bind with the receptor, but glucocorticoid will not be able to do that because of the presence of this 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, which will convert the corticosterone or the cortisol into its 11 oxy derivatives. Okay, so when these 11 oxy derivatives, they cannot bind with the mineralocorticoid receptor. So this enzyme is the savior. Now if 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase type 2, this enzyme is inhibited or absent, then what will happen? Then there will be a syndrome that is known as apparent mineralocorticoid excess, that is AME. That syndrome is known as A for apparent, then M, that is mineralocorticoid, then E is for excess. So if this enzyme is absent, so that will be apparent mineralocorticoid excess. Patients with this condition have the clinical picture of hyperaldosteronism because cortisol is acting on their mineralocorticoid receptors, and their plasma aldosterone level as well as their plasma renin activity is low. You will see that plasma renin and plasma aldosterone is okay, but the picture of hyperaldosteronism you will find. Okay, why? Because cortisol is acting on them. The condition can be due to congenital absence of this enzyme. So now come to the conditions. We can see the what are the levels of sodium, potassium and chloride when there is excess of aldosterone and when is there is less of aldosterone. So when the excess of aldosterone, we know the function of aldosterone is to enhance the sodium concentration and reduce the potassium concentration. So this is a normal value, 142 is a sodium. So it will enhance the sodium concentration, it will reduce the potassium concentration, and when there is adrenal insufficiency, the opposite thing will happen. Sodium level will be decreased and potassium level will be increased. So we have the conditions that can increase level of aldosterone, that is known as primary aldosteronism, or it may be due to the secondary hyperaldosteronism. Okay, so primary aldosteronism, it is the excess aldosterone secretion due to adrenal disease. If the disease process, it is located in the adrenal gland itself, and usual cause is adrenal adenoma, that is known as the Cone's syndrome. Okay, so adrenal adenoma, adrenal hyperplasia, adrenal carcinoma, the adrenal adenoma especially is known as the Cone syndrome. They will and it will give rise to hyperaldosteronism, that is denoted as primary hyperaldosteronism. In case of primary hyperaldosteronism, as the adrenal concentration is high, so it will give a negative action on renin, so the renin secretion is reduced. So what are the basics? So there is another conditions we can see here, the secondary hyperaldosteronism. So one is primary, another is secondary. Primary, it is due to the cause is located at the adrenal gland itself. Okay, so adrenal producing adenoma known as Cone syndrome is the cause of primary hyperaldosteronism. What is the basic difference between these two? First difference is that in primary hyperaldosteronism, the renin secretion will be decreased. Okay, and the major cause is, we know Cone syndrome is the adrenal adenoma, and these are the manifestations. When the adrenal adenoma is there, so the mineralocorticoid excess will be there, so there will be salt and water retention, extracellular fluid volume expansion, that will cause the hypertension. In addition to that, due to depletion of potassium, there will be muscle weakness. Okay, and there will be polyuria due to impaired urinary concentrating ability. So three features will be there. As there is excess extracellular fluid volume, so blood pressure will be high, and as the potassium level is less, so there will be muscle weakness, and urine concentrating ability as it is reduced, so there will be polyuria. But most importantly, in primary hyperaldosteronism, we know that renin is less. Another important point is edema is absent. Edema is absent in primary hyperaldosteronism, and this we can explain via the escape phenomenon. Okay, so when aldosterone is high, extracellular fluid volume is expanded, that will cause the increased venous return, distension of atria, and atrial stretching will lead to the secretion of atrial natriuretic peptide that will cause profound natriuresis and diuresis, and extracellular fluid volume returns back to normal. That is the reason there will be no edema. So in primary hyperaldosteronism, 2 points are important. One is renin level will be decreased and there will be no edema. Okay, and the symptoms will be hypertension, there will be muscle weakness and the polyuria. In secondary hyperaldosteronism, we can see we have seen the causes. It is due to activation of renin angiotensin system due to some secondary causes. It may be due to congestive heart failure, due to cirrhosis of liver, due to nephritic syndrome, when there is initially there is fall in extracellular fluid volume. Okay, this fall will induce the renin angiotensin system and that will enhance the aldosterone level. Okay, so in secondary hyperaldosteronism, the renin level is always high. These 2 points are very essential to remember. Primary hyperaldosteronism, renin level is decreased and there will be no edema due to ischem phenomena. In secondary hyperaldosteronism, there will be increased activation of renin angiotensin system. So, renin level will be high. So, here the ischem phenomena we can see here. It is due to the presence of atrial natriuretic peptide. Okay, and in secondary hyperaldosteronism, edema is usual, is a usual feature. We know in congestive cardiac failure, in cirrhosis of liver, the commonest presentation is the edema. Okay, in nephritic syndrome. Now, secondary hyperaldosteronism can occur also in the Bartter syndrome. We have seen there is a protein, that is a Bartin, that is located in your ascending loop of Henle, where the sodium potassium 2 chloride is actually reabsorbing the sodium. So in case of Bartter syndrome also, there may be secondary hyperaldosteronism. And the speciality is that in case of Bartter syndrome, the secondary hyperaldosteronism is there. But here, although it is a secondary hyperaldosteronism, edema will be absent. So, 1 point, primary hyperaldosteronism, again, so renin secretion is decreased and edema is absent due to escape phenomena. Secondary hyperaldosteronism, renin level is increased and the edema is present, except Bartter syndrome. Now come to zona fasciculata that secretes the glucocorticoids. Again, we will discuss these glucocorticoids. We already know their chemistry, the steps of synthesis that is occurring in the zona fasciculata. Okay, that is from the cholesterol, then 17-hydroxy pregnenolone, then pregnenolone hydroxy progesterone, then in this way. So in the second vertical line, we will see again, then when it is released into the circulation, whether it is protein bound or not, what are the target organs of these glucocorticoids, what are their mechanism of action, what are their functions, and how they are regulated and metabolized, and diseases associated with hyper and hypo secretion of glucocorticoids. We have already gone through the steps of cortisol synthesis. So now we are concentrating into this part. In the mitochondria, that is in the zona fasciculata. So the mitochondria of the zona fasciculata, the pregnenolone forms 17-hydroxypregnenolone by the enzyme 17-alpha-hydroxylase. 17-hydroxypregnenolone then moves into the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, where it is converted to 17 hydroxyprogesterone by 3 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, which in turn hydroxylated to 11 deoxycortisol by 21 beta hydroxylase. 11 deoxycortisol then moves back to mitochondria. So 11 deoxycortisol, this one, then it moves back to mitochondria to be hydroxylated to form cortisol by mitochondrial enzyme 11 beta hydroxylase. Now, regarding regulation of cortisol, so we can see here the cortisol is regulated by ACTH, so the conversion of cholesterol to pregnenolone, that is the cholesterol desmolase enzyme, that reaction is stimulated by ACTH. So we can say ACTH facilitates cortisol synthesis, and ACTH also increases the supply of cholesterol. So this is a way how we can see here the LDL cholesterol, it is entering, and initially it is moving to it is remaining in the esterated form, esterified form. So cholesterol ester hydrolase enzyme, it is converting it to the free form of cholesterol, and this free form is moving to mitochondria, where there will be this cholesterol desmolase enzyme will convert it to pregnenolone, and this step will be facilitated by ACTH. Now, regarding the mechanism of action of cortisol, we see here. First, when the cortisol it is released into the circulation, so before reaching the target organ, what will be the fate of this cortisol? So it will bind with some plasma proteins. We can see, just like other hormones, so cortisol is bound in the circulation to an alpha globulin called transcortin or corticosteroid binding globulin, CBG, corticosteroid binding globulin. And the half-life of cortisol in the circulation, it is longer because this bound form, it acts as a reservoir, and this bound form, it is as the amount of white form, bound form of cortisol is greater than that of the corticosterone. So we will see that the half-life of cortisol is 60 to 90 minutes, whereas that of the corticosterone is 50 minutes. And the bound steroids, we know as they are physiologically inactive. In addition, relatively little free cortisol and corticosterone are found in the urine because of protein binding. So at normal levels of total plasma cortisol, so that is around 13.5, we can say 13.5 microgram per deciliter, very little free cortisol is present in the plasma. So the free cortisol we can see from this picture. So 13 microgram is a plasma bound form, and 0.5 microgram per deciliter is a free form. So very little free cortisol is present in the plasma, but the binding sites on CBG become saturated when the total plasma cortisol it exceeds 20 microgram per deciliter. So if the cortisol level it increases from 13.5 microgram per deciliter, if it reaches the 20 microgram per deciliter level, in that case the all binding sites will be saturated, in that case the free cortisol level will be increased. Now one important point is there, the corticosteroid binding globulin or CBG, so it is synthesized in liver and its production is increased by estrogen. So we can alter this CBG level, okay? So the binding protein level we can alter, And if the binding protein level is increased, that means more bound form and less free form. If the binding protein level is decreased, that means less bind form and more free form. Okay, more free cortisol, more physiologically active cortisol means hyperactivity of the cortisol. So binding globulin can change the concentration of free cortisol level. Now this binding globulin, corticosteroid binding globulin levels, it is elevated during pregnancy and it is depressed in cirrhosis, because cirrhosis affects liver. Liver cannot synthesize, cannot perform its action properly. So it will be depressed in cirrhosis. It will be depressed in multiple myeloma and nephrosis. Okay. So CBC level will be elevated in pregnancy, but it's depressed in cirrhosis, nephrosis and multiple myeloma. Now when the CBG level rises, so more cortisol is bound and initially the free cortisol level drops initially. This stimulates ACTH secretion and more cortisol is secreted until a new equilibrium is reached, at which the bound cortisol is elevated but the free cortisol is normal. Now changes in the opposite direction will occur when the CBG level falls. That means if CBG is increased, the accordingly the cortisol level will be increased. So the bound form will be more, but the free form, the active, physiologically active form of cortisol, its level will remain normal. This explains why pregnant women have high total plasma cortisol level without symptoms of glucocorticoid excess. Conversely, why some patients with nephrosis have low total plasma cortisol level without symptoms of glucocorticoid deficiency. So these are the conditions we can see where the globulin level can be increased or decreased. So increased level, it is pregnancy, we can see estrogen therapy, or decreased level in case of so many conditions here. Among them, important conditions are cirrhosis of liver, it may be the nephrosis, multiple myeloma, like this. Now regarding metabolism and excretion of glucocorticoids, cortisol is metabolized in liver, which is the principal site of glucocorticoid catabolism. Now most of the cortisol is reduced to dihydrocortisol. So most of the cortisol, it will be reduced to dihydrocortisol and then to tetrahydrocortisol. And this tetrahydrocortisol will be conjugated to glucuronic acid. The glucuronyl transfer system responsible for this conversion also catalyzes the formation of glucuronides of bilirubin. Okay. Now, competitive inhibition takes place between these substrates for the enzyme system. Now, liver and other tissues, they contain 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, that specific energy which was present in the target tissue of the mineralocorticoid, which keeps the aldosterone untouched, but that will convert the cortisol to it some other form. We have already discussed about it. Okay, that 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, there are at least two form we know. Type 1 of this 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, that converts cortisol, this converts cortisol to cortisone. Okay, so type 1 catalyzes the conversion of cortisol to cortisone, and type 2 catalyzes almost exclusively the one-way conversion of cortisol to cortisone. Now this cortisone is an active glucocorticoid, because cortisone is an active glucocorticoid because it is converted to cortisol, and it is well known because of its extensive use in medicine. Okay, and it is not secreted in appreciable quantities by the adrenal gland. Okay, but what happens little, if any, of the cortisone formed in the liver enters into the circulation, because it is promptly reduced and conjugated to form tetrahydrocortisone glucuronide. And these tetrahydroglucuronide derivatives of cortisol and corticosterone are freely soluble. They enter the circulation, where they do not become bound to protein. They are rapidly excreted in urine. So we can give cortisol in a synthetic form, and this cortisol will be converted to cortisone, and they can be used as a supplement. But in vivo, what happens when this cortisol L is converted to cortisone? Although cortisone is an active glucocorticoid, but from the liver, when it is not secreted in appreciable quantities by the adrenal gland, first thing. Second, if some amount of it is secreted by the liver into the circulation, it will be readily conjugated to tetrahydrocortisone glucuronide. This is soluble and it will be rapidly excreted in the urine. Okay, so one type of metabolism is via dihydrocortisol, tetrahydrocortisol and conjugation. Another form is that cortisol will be converted to cortisone, okay, and with the help of 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase. Now, in addition to that, 10% of the secreted cortisol is converted in the liver to the 17 ketosteroid derivatives of cortisol and cortisone. Okay, these ketosteroids are conjugated for the most of the part to the sulfate and then excreted in the urine. So we can say from this, most of the glucocorticoid, the principal site of metabolism of corticosteroid, it is, or the glucocorticoid, it is liver, and it is excreted via kidney. Now, the mechanism of action and the physiologic effect of glucocorticoid. Cortisol takes few hours to days to exert its effects. It diffuses into cell and binds with the glucocorticoid receptor, this GR, present in the cytoplasm. So, as it is a steroid hormone, its receptor is intracellular, and in the cytoplasm, it will bind with this receptor. Now, binding of cortisol with its receptor displaces inhibitory heat shock protein complex from the receptor. So, we can see here, this is the heat shock protein. Initially, this heat shock protein remains combined with the glucocorticoid receptor. This is inhibitory. So, when the glucocorticoid itself, it will bind with the GCR or with this receptor. So, this inhibitory heat shock protein will be displaced. This results in alteration in the receptor configuration, and causes hyperphosphorylation of the receptor. So there will be configurational changes in the receptor. It will become hyperphosphorylated. Now the hormone receptor complex, it will now enter into the nucleus, bind with its specific glucocorticoid regulatory elements, GRE. Glucocorticoid regulatory elements on target DNA, then there will be transcription of mRNA and expression of various proteins. So step number one is glucocorticoid with its receptor binding, then displacement of heat shock protein, then configurational changes or phosphorylation of the hormone receptor complex, then it will move into the nucleus, and at the target gene it will bind with its specific GRE glucocorticoid regulatory elements, then there will be transcription of mRNA and there will be expression of various proteins. Now come to the physiological functions of the glucocorticoids. So few functions are metabolic functions, that it has effect on the carbohydrate, protein and fat metabolism. In addition to that, in several other physiological effects are also there. So first come to the metabolic functions. So we can see here glucocorticoid, it stimulates hepatic gluconeogenesis. So in the liver we can see it increases or stimulates the hepatic gluconeogenesis. Cortisol secretion increases in fasting, and cortisol induces gluconeogenic enzymes, especially it activates glucose 6-phosphatase, which converts glucose 6-phosphate to glucose, therefore increases the release of glucose from liver. Also, by causing proteolysis, it mobilizes amino acids for new gluconeogenesis. Now there will be increased secretion of glycosinolytic hormones. Another defense mechanism of cortisol against hypoglycemia is the increase in secretion of glucagon and epinephrine that causes glycogenolysis. So it will cause the glycogenolysis. Glycogenolysis will be there. Okay. And this glycosinolysis, it is mostly due to the effect of increased release of glucagon and the epinephrine. So first effect is gluconeogenesis. It will enhance the activity of glucose 6-phosphatase, as well as protein will be available, amino acids will be available for gluconeogenesis. Second thing, glycogenolysis. And this mechanism, it is mostly due to increase in the secretion of glucagon and epinephrine that causes glycogenolysis. However, cortisol partially facilitates liver glycogen synthesis. Okay. Now, third point is the anti-insulin effect. Okay. Anti-insulin effect, you will see that cortisol decreases the utilization of glucose by antagonizing the action of insulin on peripheral tissues. It prevents the mobilization of glucose transporters from cytosol to the cell membrane. We know that this GLUT or glucose transmitter enhances the glucose entry. Especially, it inhibits the insulin stimulated glucose uptake in the skeletal muscle and the adipose tissue. In the skeletal muscle and adipose tissue, the uptake of glucose will be reduced. This adds to the hyperglycemic effects of cortisol and makes diabetes worse. It also reverses insulin suppression of hepatic glucose production. So we can say that it is anti-insulin, pro-diabetogenic and ketogenic. Okay. And glucocorticoid is essential for survival during fasting. During fasting, we know when the person is having fast starvation. So at that time, the need of glucose is very much. So cortisol will act and in these subjects, and they will enhance the glucose supply. They will increase the availability of the glucose in the circulation. But in case of diabetic patients, suppose a patient is suffering from diabetes, we have to be very cautious to give them steroid medications, because cortisol, it is anti-insulin, it is pro-diabetogenic, so it can complicate diabetes. In normal individuals, rise in blood glucose by cortisol increases insulin secretion, which counteracts ketone bodies and lipids raised by the cortisol. But in diabetes, we know there is either insulin resistance or lack of insulin. So cortisol effects on ketone body and lipid remain unaffected and insulin is lacking. Thus, excess cortisol makes the diabetes worse by promoting ketoacidosis. Okay, so in normal individual, so when the insulin secretion will be increased normally, so that will counteract this ketone body formation. Okay, but when this insulin resistance is present in case of diabetic mellitus, especially in type 2, the this K ketogenesis will be unopposed, and that can complicate the diabetes. We know that it can result in diabetic ketoacidosis. So now in case of protein metabolism, we can see from this chart also, cortisol facilitates proteolysis, especially in the skeletal muscle, and inhibits protein synthesis. It mobilizes muscle protein for gluconeogenesis. It mobilizes muscle protein, so it will cause the catabolism of protein and mobilizes the amino acids to the liver and to do the gluconeogenesis. The overall action of cortisol is to facilitate the conversion of protein to glycogen. The chronic administration of cortisol or excess secretion of glucocorticoid causes depletion of protein storage in the body, especially in the muscle, bone, skin and connective tissue. On fat metabolism, cortisol causes lipolysis. So we can say in carbohydrate metabolism, it is pro-diabetogenic, so it will increase blood glucose. In protein catabolism, it will cause the lysis of protein. In fat metabolism, it will cause also lipolysis. The lipolytic effect of epinephrine and growth hormone requires cortisol. So actually, lipolytic hormones are the growth hormone and the epinephrine. So their effect will be enhanced by cortisol. During fasting, by promoting lipolysis, cortisol causes rapid release of free fatty acid and glycerol from adipose tissues, which are utilized for gluconeogenesis. Increased free acid formation promotes ketogenesis, especially in diabetes. Now, in addition to that, cortisol increases appetite and food intake by stimulating neuropeptide Y secretion from the hypothalamus. It stimulates the differentiation of pre-adipocytes to adipocytes in the adipose tissue. It also stimulates lipogenesis by activating lipoprotein lipase and glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase activity of the adipocytes in some other parts of the body. Okay, so there will be more available free fatty acids. So we can say in the liver, it will promote gluconeogenesis, glycogenolysis, ketogenesis. In the skeletal muscle, glycogenolysis and proteolysis. Okay. In the adipose tissue, lipolysis, release of fatty acid and glycerol. So there will be more available free fatty acid, which is also responsible for insulin resistance. So it will give a permissive action of glucagon and epinephrine, which will cause the glycogenolysis. In the hypothalamus, it will increase NPY, that is neuropeptide Y, which will increase the food intake, and obesity and insulin resistance will happen. So this is about the function of cortisol glucocorticoids on metabolism. Now come to other functions as well. So that is your anti-inflammatory effect. So if you look into the effects of cortisol on the inflammation, we will see that cortisol has profound anti-inflammatory and anti-allergic action. We know that inflammation is the response to tissue injury. The inflammatory responses includes what? There will be dilatation of capillaries. We know that there will be dolor, means there will be pain. There will be color. This means that area will be reddened. There will be dolor, color, and edema will be there. Okay. So we know that red coloration of the inflamed area, it is due to dilatation of capillaries. There will be accumulation of fluid will give rise to the edema because increased capillary permeability. Why there will be pain? Because migration of granulocytes to the site of injury and killing of organisms and releasing so many chemokines that are responsible for it. Now these responses are mediated by various chemicals. We know that so many pro-inflammatory chemokines are there, like prostaglandin, thromboxane, leukotrienes, histamine, serotonin, like this, EDRF, platelet activating factor. Now, cortisol interferes in most of the mechanisms of inflammation. What are those? First is that cortisol inhibits synthesis of chemical mediators of inflammation. For example, it stimulates synthesis of lipoproteins, a family of phosphoproteins in the target cell. Now, what is the function of this lipoprotein? Lipoprotein, it inhibits the activity of phospholipase A2. Therefore, we know that phospholipase A2, it helps in the formation of arachidonic acid. So, there will be reduced release of arachidonic acid. Okay. And which is the precursor? This arachidonic acid is the precursor of all these chemical mediators like prostaglandin, thromboxane, leukotrienes. Thus, cortisol prevents the formation of these mediators at the site of inflammation. So, this is your number one function. Number two is cortisol stabilizes the lysosomal membrane. It stabilizes lysosomal membrane. Therefore, it decreases release of proteolytic enzymes and hyaluronidase from the lysosomes that are required for inflammatory reactions to occur. So, reduced release of proteolytic enzyme, so reduced inflammatory injury. Now, the step number three, that is inhibition of the mast cells. So, cortisol inhibits mast cell. It prevents differentiation and proliferation of muscle. There consequently, we know that from the muscle, the histamine is released. So, consequently, it decreases the release of histamine, an important mediator of inflammation, because histamine causes vasodilatation and capillary permeability. So, this is the action number three. Now, action number four, anti-inflammatory action number four is that its action on leukocytes. Cortisol inhibits leukocyte function. It prevents migration of leukocytes to the site of inflammation or infection. It prevents, so there are so many steps of aggregation of this leukocyte at the site of inflammation. Number one is the migration of leukocyte, that is prevented. Then the margination of leukocyte and adherence of leukocyte to the capillary endothelial, that is prevented. Cortisol inhibits the expression of receptors in the endothelial cells that normally causes chemotactic peptides to interact with leukocytes to stick to the vessel endothelium. So, this is the action on leukocyte. Now, the fifth action, cortisol inhibits the In addition to reduce chemotaxis, it also inhibits the phagocytic process and the bactericidal activity of the neutrophils. Okay, though cortisol causes mild neutrophilia, you will see later, but it actually decreases the activity of leukocyte. Although neutrophil count will be somewhat increased in case of steroid therapy, but the activity of the neutrophils will be less. Cortisol inhibits the fibroblast proliferation, thus decreases the synthesis and deposition of fibrils as the site of inflammation. This forms the basis of chronic anti-inflammatory action of cortisol to injury. So, cortisol prevents swelling off of a chronic infection. Now, the next action is, recent evidences suggest that a transcription factor or NF-kappa-B. This is NF-kappa-B. It plays an important role in inflammation. Normally what happens, this NF-kappa-B, it remains bound to another cytoplasmic protein known as I-kappa-B. Okay, so the NF-kappa-B and I-kappa-B, they are friend at normal inactive state. Now, viruses and cytokines that induce the that induce inflammation, they separate this NF-kappa-B from I-kappa-B by activating I-kappa-B kinase. Okay, so inflammatory reaction will cause the separation between NF-kappa-B and I-kappa-B. Now, NF-kappa-B will be free. It will migrate to the nucleus. It will attach with the DNA. This induces the transcription of genes for formation of various chemicals that participate in inflammation. Thus, NF-kappa B stimulates synthesis and secretion of mediators of inflammation. Okay, so NF-kappa B, it is very much important for inflammation. Now, what does steroid do? Glucocorticoids increase the production of I-kappa B. So it will increase the I-kappa B. More I-kappa B means they will remain, this NF-kappa B and I-kappa B will remain friend for forever. There will be no one to separate them. Okay, so cortisol will prevent the activation of NF-kappa B. This is suggested to be the primary mechanism of anti-inflammatory actions of cortisol. Okay, so nevertheless, the physician has to be cautious to use the cortisol to prevent inflammation. Now come to the function of the effect of cortisol on the blood cells. How it is affecting the blood cells. So before going to that, a few points about the allergy. Cortisol has some anti-allergic effect also. So from the previous slide, we have seen that they will prevent the release of histamine. Histamine is very much the requirement for the required for this itching, redness and swelling of allergy. In systemic allergy like anaphylactic reaction, there also histamine plays a very important role. So anti-allergy effect of cortisol, it is mainly by preventing the release of histamine and the growth of mast cell. So these two are very important. Okay. Now come to the action of cortisol on the blood cells. So we can see here from this graph that there will be glucocorticoids will decrease the number of circulating eosinophils. So eosinophil count, we can see here from this graph, it is clear that the eosinophil count, it is reduced, marked reduction of eosinophil count. Okay, it is due to the sequestration of eosinophil in the spleen and lungs. Glucocorticoids also lower the number of basophil. It lowers the number of basophil. We can see that half, its level is halved, we can see here. Glucocorticoids decrease the circulating lymphocyte count and the size of the lymph nodes and thymus by inhibiting lymphocyte mitotic activity. So what are the cells whose level will, whose count will be reduced? Lymphocytes, eosinophils and the basophil. Now, cortisol reduces secretion of cytokines, as we have already told, by inhibiting the NF-kappa B, action of the NF-kappa B. So, the cell counts which will be affected, which will be reduced by cortisol, are eosinophil, basophil and the lymphocytes. Okay. So, there will be eosinopenia and there will be lymphocytopenia. But there will be mild erythrocytosis. We can see here the RBC count will be increased. Mild erythrocytosis. And we can see the polymorphonuclear cells, that is the neutrophil count, it is increased. The neutrophil count, it is increased. Although there is reduction in lymphocyte, eosinophil, basophil, two cell counts will be increased. One is your red blood cell, mild increase, and the polymorphonuclear cell count, it can be increased, the neutrophilia. And we have seen that although the neutrophil count is increased, the activity of neutrophil will be reduced. That's why it is anti-inflammatory. Now the actions of or the effect of glucocorticoids on different other organs. So first come to the kidney and the water metabolism. Cortisol increases GFR by increasing glomerular blood flow. and it is essential for the rapid clearance of a water load, that is fast excretion of water from the body, as happens in infusion of saline or glucose solution. So cortisol, so it will help in the excretion of more water from the body, and it achieves this partly by inhibiting ADH secretion. Therefore, in the absence of cortisol, free water clearance is impaired and dilution of urine is limited. It also increases phosphate excretion by inhibiting reabsorption of it in proximal tubule. Okay. Now, be cautious. One should be very cautious while infusing glucose solution in case of cortisol deficiency. Now, patients with adrenocortical insufficiency cannot excrete a water load. We can see that because cortisol is enhancing the water secretion, so in insufficiency of cortisol will enhance the body water load. Okay. Now, in these patients, if you give sudden infusion of large volume of saline or glucose solution, it will lead to overload of water, that is water intoxication. So following infusion of glucose saline, the glucose is metabolized, but the body cannot remove water as cortisol is lacking. Therefore, plasma will become hypoosmolar due to hemodilation. The cells in the brain will swell up. That impairs the hypothalamic thermoregulatory centers. Patients develop high fever and collapses. Therefore, such patients should receive cortisol while receiving a water load. Okay, so cortisol deficiency, if the patient is having cortisol deficiency, and if you are planning to give the patients any kind of saline infusion, so you have to give supplementary cortisol first. Then you give the infusion. Okay. Now, I have told you about the role of 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase type 2 that converts the cortisol into the cortisone. And we know that cortisol has marked mineralocorticoid activity. Now, in patients which develop the hyperaldosteronism, though the plasma aldosterone and plasma renin activity remains low, hence the condition is called apparent mineralocorticoid excess. So we have discussed it before. Okay, now the action of cortisol on the cardiovascular system. So we can see from this graph that what are the effects of cortisol on the cardiovascular system. So it will enhance the blood pressure. We can see from here, it will increase the blood pressure. It will increase the cardiac contractility, cardiac output, and altered baroreflex and cardiovascular reflexes. That will happen in case of cortisol secretion. This is the effect of cortisol on the cardiovascular system. Okay. Now its action on the central nervous system. Its action on the central nervous system. Cortisol influences the mood and behavior of individual. There are abundant glucocorticoid receptors in the limbic system, including prefrontal cortex. Cortisol decreases REM sleep, but increases the slow wave sleep. It impairs the memory. There will be it causes elevation and depression of mood. So mood alteration or fluctuation will be there. It decreases the responsiveness to gustatory, olfactory, auditory, and visual stimuli. The patients with adrenal insufficiency develop changes in personality and remain irritable and apprehensive. So these are the functions of cortisol on the central nervous system. Regarding musculoskeletal system, we have already gone through in the section of metabolism that it will cause the proteolysis in the skeletal muscle. Now, in muscle, actually, cortisol increases the performance of skeletal muscle initially. The inotropic effect on skeletal muscle is due to increase in the acetylcholine synthesis at the nerve muscle terminal, that is neuromuscular junction. At the neuromuscular junction, the acetylcholine synthesis will be enhanced via cortisol. That will increase the contractility of the skeletal muscle. However, so we know that so many athletes, they take the they dope with steroids. Because why? Because steroids can increase the performance of skeletal muscle by increasing the concentration of acetylcholine at the neuromuscular junction. Okay. However, cortisol in excess, if it is in excess, it will decrease the muscle protein synthesis, promotes proteolysis. Therefore, it decreases the muscle mass and strength. Okay. On bone, cortisol inhibits the bone formation. Firstly, it decreases the synthesis of type 1 collagen. It inhibits the conversion of osteoprogenitor cells to osteoblasts. It decreases absorption of calcium from gut. It also decreases the synthesis of active vitamin D. So the calcium supply to bone, it will be less. There will be less bone mineralization, and cortisol also facilitates the bone resorption. Okay, so collagen formation is prevented, so bone matrix will suffer. So it will inhibit the conversion of osteoprogenitor to osteoblast. It decreases absorption of calcium, so the mineralization of bone will be faulty. So all of them, they will decrease the bone mass and mineralization, resulting in osteoporosis. Okay, it will result in osteoporosis. So here, relative potencies of glucocorticoids compared with cortisol, we have seen it earlier. So this is the function of cortisol at the bone. We can see here, so the osteoclastic activity is increased. So osteoclastic activity is increased, and there will be osteoprotogenin level will be low. So bone formation is low and bone resorption is more. So bone formation, bone mineralization, everything will suffer, and the bone will become osteoporotic. So these are the, in nutshell, the functions of cortisol. Now the another major function of cortisol, one function we have seen, that is anti-inflammatory function. Another function is anti-stress function. We know that any kind of stress, there will be increased release of CRH, ACTH and the cortisol. So the most important function of the cortisol is to protect the body against stress. In absence of glucocorticoids, body cannot cope with stress even in mild intensity. Okay. So how it is helping to combat stress? The glucocorticoid secretion increases due to increased ACTH secretion. We know that the stress factors, during the stress, we actually need to have more glucose level to be supplied in our body. Okay. And glucocorticoid is essential for catecholamines to exert their free fatty acid mobilizing action. Because free fatty acid is an important source of energy supply in emergency situations. And glucocorticoid will break down the lipid, okay, and generate the free fatty acid. And it is responsible. We know that the sympathetic nervous system, whose neurotransmitters are the catecholamines, they are the system of emergency. Okay. So these catecholamines, they require free fatty acids for their actions. In the emergency, catecholamines are the main fighter. They require free fatty acid for their activity. And the availability of free fatty acid will be enhanced by glucocorticoid. And this is also important for maintenance of vascular reactivity to catecholamines as well. Therefore, in absence of cortisol, the individual succumbs to stress. So we can see that the enhanced vascular reactivity, and there will be effect in the metabolism. We know that stimulation of protein catabolism, stimulation of liver, uptake of amino acids and gluconeogenesis, formation of glucose and the free fatty acid. Everything is required for the emergency reactions in stress. Okay, then also there will be inhibition of inflammation and inhibitions of non-essential functions like reproduction and growth. So here we can see the rapid reaction of adrenal cortex of a rat to stress. So here in the x-axis, time is plotted in seconds and then minutes. And we can see the level of plasma corticosterone and adrenal corticosterone. We can see that their level within a second to minutes, their level, this plasma corticosterone and the adrenal corticosterone, their level is how much it is increased as a result of stress. What kind of stress was applied? There in this experimental animal, the fracture of tibia and fibula was caused. Okay, so this stress in the form of fracture of bone, this is a kind of stretch and stress and emergency. So within a minute we can see there is rise in corticosteroid level. Okay, this indicates that this is anti-stress. Now the permissive actions of glucocorticoids. What is permissive action? The action of some hormones are executed only in the presence of glucocorticoids. For example, calorigenic action of glucagon, lipolytic activity of catecholamines, pressor effects of catecholamines and bronchodilatation by catecholamines. Okay? So, these are the factors, permissive actions of glucocorticoids. Now, from it, we can see that the glucocorticoid have so many therapeutic effect. It is anti-allergy, it is anti-inflammatory, okay, it is immunosuppressive. That's why it can be given, it can prevent the graft rejections like this, okay. But in addition to that, so many other, it has also some permissive actions like it will cause a bronchodilatation done by catecholamines, calorigenic actions like this, surfactant synthesis, development of bacterial flora. These are some good actions. These are some good actions of cortisols. And cortisols, they are anti-shock. We know that pressure actions means they will increase the blood pressure. Okay. They will enhance the activity of catecholamines. So catecholamines is vasoconstrictor. It will enhance the blood pressure. So injection of cortisol, it is a must in shock, we can say. Injection of catecholamines in hypovolemic shock is required to restore the blood pressure as they cause vasoconstriction and increase the cardiac output. This is also a very good effect of, very important effect of cortisol. So it is immunosuppressive, it is anti-inflammatory, anti-allergy, okay. In addition to that, it is very essential for shock. To revert the shock, it will cause the vasoconstriction, it will increase the cardiac output, okay. And this action is particularly done by the permissive action of catecholamines, okay. In addition to that, we know that in fetus, the lung development is also promoted. The the growth of the alveoli and flattening of alveolar epithelial cell, it is also facilitated by cortisol. So cortisol has so many good actions. But in addition to that, it will cause so many other effects like osteoporosis, there will be myopathies, okay. There will be skin thinning, it is diabetogenic, okay. Sometimes this immunosuppressive action may be fatal, but it is immunosuppressive action, actually it is due to the decrease in the circulating T lymphocytes, okay. That is especially helpful in case of transplantation. And so the indications and contraindications of cortisol use, we must know, okay. So many good effects as well as so many bad effects like diabetics, like osteoporosis, like neuropsychiatric disorder, like hypertensions, okay. So the indications and contraindications of cortisol use should be very clear. We know that it is used in the inflammatory disease. It is frequently used to prevent the transplant rejection. Okay. It is used for anaphylactic shock, for local and systemic allergy. And a patient suffering from acute infection should not be treated with steroids without antibiotic. Okay, I am suffering from acute infection. Suppose I am in this acute infection, the patient is suffering from, say, the bronchoconstriction, severe respiratory distress. In that case, steroid can be given, but under the cover of antibiotic. Okay, but because it suppresses the inflammation and dramatically improves the condition, okay, but it suppresses the immunity too. So the spread of infection will be so severe, the patient will develop septicemia and patient may die due to septicemic shock. Okay, so in case of acute infectious disease, you can use steroid under the cover of antibiotic. Okay, and there are so many misuses of steroids. We know that prednisolone, it has a predominantly glucocorticoid activity, dexamethasone, okay, its activity, and so many misuses of it we can see, we have seen in case of athletes. And also, now another important side effect of steroid is it stimulates gastric acid secretion, so it will cause the acidity, gastritis. So steroid therapy should be always accompanied with the antacids. Okay, so these are the few major functions of steroids. Now we have come to know about so many functions of steroids. So we must know, we will have an idea when in some disease condition, if the glucocorticoid concentration is high. One important condition is Cushing's syndrome. This is a pathological condition that occurs due to hypersecretion of glucocorticoid. Okay, so one important point is that we can understand what will be the clinical features of this Cushing's syndrome patient. There will be centripetal obesity and overweight. Okay, because this is due to peculiar distribution of body fat, in which fat is deposited more in the abdomen and the upper back. Now the fat pad in the lower neck, it is known as the buffalo's hump. So fat pad here, it is your buffalo's hump. And there will be moon faces. Face will be moon faces. Faces will be there. So buffalo's hump, red round face, moon faces, high blood sugar, high blood pressure, vertigo, blurry vision, female balding, water retention, menstrual irregularities, thin skin due to, we know that the protein catabolism, purple stri, poor wound healing, hirsutism, severe depression, cognitive difficulties, emotional instability, sleep disorder, fatigue, everything will happen in excess cortisol, that is in Cushing's syndrome. So these are some other features we can see here: easy bruisability and the stri, moon face, and fatigability, thin limbs will be there. The skin and subcutaneous tissue are thin as a result of protein catabolism, and capillaries of the skin will become thin and fragile. Therefore, minor injury causes ecchymosis or bruises, like subcutaneous hemorrhages will be there. Okay, poor wound healing, hyperglycemia, osteoporosis, all will be the clinical features of this Cushing syndrome. Okay, that is hypersecretion of glucocorticoids. So this is a feature of, we can see it is the initial phase of the boy, okay, named Aryan, and after Cushing syndrome we can see the moon faces. And one important point is that that Cushing syndrome can be ACTH dependent or ACTH independent. Okay. So traditionally, ACTH dependent one, that is the Cushing's, that is due to the ACTH producing tumor in the pituitary when the glucocorticoid level becomes excess. That particular thing is known as Cushing's disease. Okay. Now, in the pituitary, there is a pituitary tumor that is secreting ACTH and that enhances the glucocorticoid level. That particular thing is the Cushing's disease. Whereas Cushing's syndrome refers to all the causes of cortisol excess. So, as a whole, the whole thing is Cushing's syndrome. But particularly, if Cushing's syndrome is happening due to the ACTH secreting pituitary tumor, then we will call it the Cushing's disease. Okay, the common causes are adrenal hyperplasia, adrenal tumor, like this. Now, the regulation of glucocorticoids. The major regulator of glucocorticoids is ACTH. ACTH not only produces prompt increases in the glucocorticoid secretion, but also increases the sensitivity of adrenal gland to subsequent doses of ACTH. Okay, so we can say that the ACTH, it is from this picture we can see that ACTH, it is released from this area of the this is a release of the CRH. So CRH is released from this arcuate nuclei or from this area of the hypothalamus by this hypothalamus pituitary portal circulation. It will come to the anterior lobe of the pituitary, where it will act on the corticotropes, from where the ACTH hormone will be secreted, and this ACTH hormone will go to its target organ, that is the adrenal cortex. Okay, especially now we are discussing about the zona fasciculata. Okay, so this is an hypothalamo pituitary adrenal axis, and we know that in case of excess cortisol can give a long loop feedback inhibition to hypothalamus, a long loop from adrenal gland to hypothalamus, a long loop inhibition, or it may give a short loop inhibition to the pituitary as well. So when the CRH is released and it is releasing the corticotropes, what is happening is seen in this picture. So this CRH will bind with its plasma receptor. This is CRH receptor. So that is a G protein coupled receptor that will activate the adenyl cyclase, that will increase the intracellular CMP, and protein kinase A will be increased. So that will enhance the calcium entry and exocytosis of ACTH into the circulation. These ACTH now will go to the adrenal cortex, and again it will bind with the its cell membrane receptor. This is also G protein coupled receptor. It will enhance the activity of adenyl cyclase, enhanced activity of synthesis of CMP. There will be increased activity of protein kinase, okay, and synthesis of several other enzymes. So this is the mechanism of regulation via ACTH. Okay, and ACTH is a polypeptide hormone containing 39 amino acids. Now, if we look into the synthesis of most of these peptide hormones, we will see that they are generated especially in the precursor form, that is a pre-pro hormone. Then it will be converted to pro hormone, then it is the active hormone. Okay, so this pre-pro hormone of for the synthesis of ACTH is POMC, pro-opiomelanocortin, which has got a specific component known as melanocyte stimulating hormone or MSH. So that is important. This has a clinical importance that we will tell you later. Now, in addition to ACTH, the glucocorticoid synthesis, it will be stimulated. It will vary with the biological clock of our system, that is circadian rhythm. Now, ACTH is secreted in regular bursts throughout the day, and plasma cortisol level tends to rise and fall in response to these bursts. Okay, and it is seen that 75% of daily production of cortisol, it occurs between 4 a.m. to day name. Okay, the bursts are least frequent in the evening. So one important, most important regulator is ACTH. Second is the diurnal variation. The maximum synthesis will be between the, in the early morning, that is 4 a.m. to 10 a.m. Okay, and then in the evening there will be less secretion of glucocorticoid. So this is the diurnal variation we can see here. So the burst, it is most frequent from 4 a.m. to 10 a.m. Okay, and in the evening the frequency of burst, it is much more lesser. So this is our hypothalamo pituitary adrenal axis, and it is functioning through the negative feedback activity. Now one important point I would like to mention here, that glucocorticoid therapy, so that has a clinical importance, because we know that if we give, as it is functioning through the negative feedback, so if there is excess glucocorticoid in our body, that will give a negative effect on CRH as well as ACTH. So there will be less level of CRH, less level of CRH and ACTH. Okay, so negative feedback mechanism will act in this way. Okay, now suppose a patient is treated with steroid therapy for a longer duration of time, prolonged treatment with glucocorticoid. It should not be stopped suddenly. Okay, it should not be stopped suddenly. Okay, not only is a adrenal when there is prolonged therapy of glucocorticoid, not only the adrenal atrophy will be there, unresponsiveness after such treatment will also there. Okay, and it is seen that when the exogenous cortisol level therapy, it is withdrawn, it takes a long time for the ACTH and cortisol to reach their normal level. Okay, so ACTH secretion slowly increases to supranormal level. Okay, and in case of, so ACTH, you can see here, it takes around 6 months, okay, to become normal. Okay, when the steroid therapy is withdrawn. And what about the cortisol level? It takes around 8 to 10 months after the withdrawal of steroid. So prolonged therapy of steroid means suppression of ACTH, suppression of adrenal cortex. And when the steroid is withdrawn, they will very slowly, very gradually, they will reach their actual level. Okay, now in these conditions, okay, the complications of sudden cessation of steroid therapy, if this condition is suddenly the steroid therapy is stopped, okay, in these conditions there will be if any stress happen, the person will be unable to combat the stress, and this may prove fatal. Okay, so as they are very slowly, very gradually reaching their previous level, so they are not at their actual level by which they can prevent the stress. So in this condition, if suddenly any stress happens, so what will happen? So that may cause a fatal condition. That's why, how can we prevent it? Never stop the chronic steroid therapy suddenly. You decrease the steroid dose over a long period of time. Suppose the patient is getting 40 milligram per day, you can reduce to 30, then 20, now 10, then 15, then 10. In this way, gradually you take time so that it can reach its original level. Okay, so that is clinically very important. Now come to the next part, that is the zona reticularis, which is the area for synthesis of adrenal androgens. Okay, so we can see that in the zona reticularis, they have has more of the cofactors required for the synthesis of 17-23 lyase activity. So the several moderately active male sex hormones called adrenal androgens are continually secreted by the adrenal cortex, especially during fetal life. Also, progesterone and estrogen, which are female sex hormones, are secreted in minute quantities. Normally, the adrenal androgens have only weak effects in humans. It is possible that part of the early development of the male sex organs result from childhood secretion of adrenal androgens. The adrenal androgens also exert mild effects in female, not only before puberty but also throughout life. Much of the growth of the pubic and axillary hair in female results from the action of these hormones. The extra adrenal tissue, in extra adrenal tissues, some of the adrenal androgens are converted to testosterone in primary male sex hormone, which probably accounts for much of their androgenic activity. Now come to adrenal medulla. So adrenal medulla bridges the endocrine and sympathetic nervous system. Okay, so what are the hormones that are secreted from adrenal medulla? We already know adrenal medullary hormones are epinephrine, norepinephrine and dopamines. Okay, epinephrine, norepinephrine and dopamine. Now adrenal medulla has neuroendocrine function. The cells of the medulla termed chromaffin cells because the catecholamines that they contain stain avidly with chromium, derive from neural crest cells and migrate into the center of the adrenal cortex, which is derived from the mesoderm. So we know that in the developmental stage, the adrenal medulla is actually developing from mesoderm, and there will be migration of this neural crest cells that will form the chromaffin cells. The adrenomedullary cells synthesize and secrete epinephrine and to a lesser extent norepinephrine. Norepinephrine is also a neurotransmitter of sympathetic division of autonomic nervous system. Both norepinephrine and epinephrine main in the adrenal medulla enter the circulation and act on distal tissues like other hormones. So norepinephrine, that is neurotransmitter that is released at the sympathetic neural synapses, that is, that's this action is local, whereas norepinephrine and epinephrine that is synthesized in the adrenal medulla, they are hormones, so they will be released in the circulation, then they will act to the target organ. That is a basic difference between the neurotransmitter norepinephrine and hormone norepinephrine. Chromaffin cells are the structural and functional equivalents of postganglionic neurons in the sympathetic nervous system. The preganglionic sympathetic fibers of the splanchnic nerves, which release acetylcholine, are the principal regulators of adrenomedullary hormone secretion. The vascular supply of adrenal medulla is also unusual. The medulla receives vascular input from vessels that begin in the subcapsular plexus of the adrenal cortex. The vessels then branch into capillary network in the cortex only to merge into small venous vessels that branch into the second capillary network within the medulla. This portal blood supply, so there is another very small portal blood supply in the adrenal medulla, originating at the entrance of the adrenal, exposes the adrenal medulla to the highest concentration of glucocorticoids and mineralocorticoids of all somatic tissues. Now this is how the adrenal medullary hormones are synthesized. So adrenal medulla, we know it is the inner zone of adrenal gland. It consists about 20 to 30% of the adrenal mass, and it represents an enlarged and specialized sympathetic ganglion in which the postganglionic fibers are embedded and modified to become the endocrine cells. Now, within the chromaffin cells, what will be the steps of synthesis of catecholamines? The catecholamines are synthesized from amino acid phenylalanine and tyrosine. So we can see here the conversion of tyrosine will occur into the DOPA, and it is catalyzed by the enzyme tyrosine hydroxylase, and DOPA will be converted to dopamine, and this is also catabolized by the enzyme DOPA decarboxylase. Okay, now these dopamine, now it is entering into this vesicle. Norepinephrine is formed by hydroxylation and decarboxylation of tyrosine, and epinephrine is formed by methylation of norepinephrine by phenyl ethanolamine N-methyl transferase. So here you can see the dopamine is entering, and ultimately it is forming the norepinephrine. Now norepinephrine, it is stored, it will remain stored in the vesicle. So whenever there is increased calcium, so it is exocytosed. When it is exocytosed, it is coming into the cytoplasm. So here we are having another enzyme, that is PNMT, that is your phenyl ethanolamine N-methyl transferase, that will convert the norepinephrine to epinephrine. Now after synthesis, the hormones are stored in the granules of chromaffin cells before they are secreted into the venous blood. Now this PNMT enzyme, especially this enzyme, it is induced by glucocorticoid at higher concentration. It may be noted that concentration of glucocorticoids is normally high in blood bathing adrenal medulla, as blood from the cortex drains into the medulla before entering the general circulation. Therefore, in adrenocortical deficiency, epinephrine synthesis is also reduced. Also, glucocorticoid promotes normal growth of adrenal medulla. So one question may be there. So when there is adrenocortical insufficiency, the adrenal medullary hormones will also be reduced. Why? Because this adrenocortical hormone, especially the glucocorticoid, it has the facilitating effect in the formation of epinephrine. Okay, and we know that all the blood through the portal circulation, they are converging from the cortex, they are converging on the medulla. Medulla is getting highest concentration of the all adrenal cortical hormones. So if these cortical hormones are less, so there will be less production of epinephrine too. So this is the way from tyrosine. Initially it will be converted to DOPA, then DOPA will be converted to dopamine, then dopamine will be converted to norepinephrine, then with this PNMT, norepinephrine is converted to epinephrine. Now chromaffin cells of the adrenal medulla are the only ones that have the enzyme for synthesizing epinephrine. So norepinephrine can be synthesized in so many neuromuscular junctions, in sympathetic nerve terminals, but epinephrine synthesis, it will only and only happen within the chromaffin cell because it has got this specific enzyme PNMT. Now regarding the metabolism of this enzyme, the normal we can see that 70% norepinephrine and epinephrine and 90% of dopamine are conjugated in the sulfate, and they have very short lifespan. Half-life is around 1 to 3 minutes. They are metabolized primarily in the liver and kidney. The key enzymes of metabolism are COMT. COMT is catecholamine O-methyl transferase enzyme, or MAO, that is monoamino oxidase. These are major enzymes which helps in the metabolism of the catecholamines. Metabolism of epinephrine forms metanephrine. And norepinephrine forms the normetanephrine. Epinephrine and norepinephrine are also commonly degraded to form dihydroxymandelic acid. They will form the dihydroxymandelic acid. and which is further metabolized to form the VMA or vanillyl mandelic acid and methoxyhydroxyphenylglucose. Okay, phenyl glycol. So epinephrine, the end product is metanephrine. Norepinephrine, the end product is normetanephrine. They also can produce dihydroxymandelic acid, which can be converted to VMA or vinyl mandelic acid. Okay. So the steps of degradation of epinephrine and norepinephrine we know. Okay. Now, in normal daily urinary excretion of catecholamines and metabolites, you will see that the maximum excretion will be of VMA or vinyl mandelic acid. That's why this VMA is an important index of sympathetic activity. Urinary excretion of VMA and MOPG also reflect activity of sympathetic nervous system, as they are mainly derived from norepinephrine. Epinephrine contributes relatively less to the production of VMA and MOPG. Therefore, the activity of adrenal medulla is assessed primarily by the measurement of plasma epinephrine or free urinary epinephrine. Okay, so adrenal medullary function, we know the medulla is only specific for epinephrine. Norepinephrine can be synthesized somewhere in another parts of the body also. So if we want to measure the functional ability of adrenal medulla, then we have to measure the plasma epinephrine or free urinary epinephrine level. But if we want to have an idea of the sympathetic activity of our body, then we will measure urinary VMA. Okay, because norepinephrine is a major contributor of this VMA. Now, what are the functions of this physiological actions of catecholamines? We will see that it will cause the epinephrines. They will cause the cardiac stimulations. And blood vessels and muscles, they will also have effect, and they have effect on the tissue metabolism. And usually they act through different catecholamine receptors. For example, they act through the alpha and beta receptors. There are three varieties of beta receptor, beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3, and two types of alpha receptor, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Alpha 1 and alpha 2 receptors have so many subtypes. Okay, so here we can see that alpha receptors will cause the vasoconstriction, iris dilatation, intestinal relaxation, intestinal sphincter contraction, pylomotor contraction, bladder sphincter contraction, inhibits the neurotransmitter release. Whereas beta receptors, they will cause the vasodilatation, cardioacceleration, increased myocardial strength by beta 1, intestinal relaxation by beta 2, uterine relaxation by beta 2, bronchodilatation by beta 2, calorigenesis by beta 2, glycogenolysis by beta 2, lipolysis beta 1, bladder wall relaxation beta 2, and thermogenesis beta 3. These are the receptors by which they can act. Okay, and as a whole, we can say that they will increase the beta receptors, they will increase the stimulate the gluconeogenesis and the glycogenolysis. They will enhance the glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. They will also enhance the lipolysis. Okay, they will increase the free fatty acid level, and they will also enhance the ketone body level. Okay, and one of the important function of them, they are thermogenic action. Okay, epinephrine is a more potent than norepinephrine. So epinephrine increases BMR, basal metabolic rate. It increases the non-shivering thermogenesis and diet-induced thermogenesis both. Okay. And during hypoglycemia, we know that this sympathetic system, the catecholamine system, it is the system of emergency. So they will be stimulated in any kind of stressful condition and will try to combat the stress. So here we can see the effect of norepinephrine and epinephrine, especially on the cardiovascular system, which will give an idea, because these catecholamines are the responsible for flight and fight reaction, because they will increase the cardiac output, promote the blood flow in organs, increase in ventilation, everything they will that is needed for the emergency situation. Okay, now we want to concentrate on the effects of cardiovascular system specially. First is the effect of epinephrine. If we look into the effect of epinephrine, epinephrine increases heart rate and force of myocardial contraction, okay, and cardiac output, okay, and the systolic blood pressure will be increased. Okay, so due to its increased cardiac output, the systolic blood pressure will be increased. Okay, and there will be selective arteriolar constriction in the renal, splanchnic and cutaneous vascular bed. However, epinephrine can produce vasodilatation in the skeletal and hepatic circulation via B2 receptors. Okay, now vasodilatation effect of epinephrine overrides the vasoconstriction effect. Therefore, total peripheral resistance falls and diastolic blood pressure decreases mildly. So we can say that epinephrine will increase the systolic blood pressure by increasing the cardiac output. Okay, but because of specific vasodilatation in the areas like the skeletal muscle, okay, so there will be fall in the peripheral resistance, diastolic blood pressure will decrease mildly, and the pulse pressure, that is the systolic and diastolic, the difference, pulse pressure will widen. Okay, whereas the norepinephrine produces vasoconstriction via alpha 1 receptors, okay, and it increases peripheral resistance and increases diastolic blood pressure. So the norepinephrine produces some degree of tachycardia too. Okay, so however, hypertension produced by norepinephrine stimulates baroreceptors in the carotid sinus, and there may be reflex bradycardia after a certain time. Okay, so we can say here the epinephrine will cause rise in SBP and fall in DBP, whereas norepinephrine will cause both in rise in SBP and rise in DBP. Another important point is there, in shock or circulatory failure, sympathetic stimulation that causes catecholamine secretion benefits the individual. But if this shock persists for a longer duration of time and catecholamine synthesis is prolonged, then the effect will be deleterious, because renal vasoconstriction will lead to less blood flow to kidney and compromise the kidney function. Okay, so decreased splanchnic circulation will impair the visceral functions, so the patient may suffer from multi-organ failure. Now the hyper and hyposecretion of hormones. Now the hypofunction of the adrenal gland may be primary or secondary. Primary means there will be either atrophy of the gland or surgical removal of the gland. Secondary adrenal insufficiency, it is secondary to pituitary disease or hypothalamic disease. Okay, so hypothalamus, if it secretes less amount of CRH, or pituitary, if it secretes less amount of ACTH, then the secondary type of adrenocortical insufficiency will be developed. But if it is due to the adrenal gland itself, then it is the primary adrenocortical insufficiency, and most common cause is the idiopathic atrophy of the gland due to some autoimmune process, and it is known as the Addison's disease. So in Addison's disease, there will be hyposecretion of the adrenal cortical hormones as a result of the atrophy of the adrenal gland, and it is an autoimmune mechanism is responsible for that. Okay, however, tubercular infection of the adrenal gland, metastasis, amyloidosis, cytomegalovirus infection also may destroy and produce the Addison's disease. Now, what will be the clinical features? So, less amount of adrenal cortical hormones. So, there will be loss of weight. There will be easy fatigability. There will be hypotension, decreased mineralocorticoid activity, anorexia, nausea, sometimes abdominal pain, hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, because we know aldosterone, it will retain sodium, it will excrete potassium. So as sodium is not retained, so hyponatremia, there will be hyperkalemia, okay. There will be loss of weight, there will be eosinophilia, and in addition to that will be vitiligo and vomiting, nausea, diarrhea, constipation like this. And most importantly, there will be hyperpigmentation of the skin. So why hyperpigmentation? It is especially it is marked over the pressure points and sun exposed area and on the scar marks. Because less plasma cortisol means more ACTH secretion by feedback mechanism, and ACTH has an intrinsic MSH or melanocyte stimulating hormone activity. That's why there will be hyperpigmentation. So here we can see that the feedback mechanism, if the less amount of cortisol level or other adrenal cortical level is there, so negative feedback is withdrawn, more amount of ACTH is secreted, and this ACTH, it is there, we can see this is the pro-opiomelanocortin, this is the precursor form, pre-pro hormone. Then there will be formation of the pro hormone here, and we can see an alpha MSH constituents here and the beta MSH melanocyte stimulating hormone constituents here. So ACTH has some intrinsic MSH activity which is responsible for its hyperpigmentation effect. And how we can treat it by giving hormone replacement therapy. Now most frequently the primary atrophy, which is due to autoimmunity or tuberculosis destruction or maybe the cancer. So now come to the Cushing's syndrome. We have already discussed the clinical features, and we know if it is due to the specifically due to the pituitary adenoma, then we will call it the Cushing's disease. Otherwise, the whole thing, the glucocorticoid excess, it is a Cushing syndrome. Okay, some may be ACTH dependent due to excess ACTH, and this excess ACTH, if it is due to pituitary adenoma, then this specifically we will call it Cushing's disease. Okay. Excess pituitary ACTH can be due to excess ACTH can be due to ectopic conditions, like that is ACTH is not secreted from the pituitary, it is secreted by someone else. Okay, it may be the bronchial carcinoma sometimes may secrete ACTH. Okay, so in that ectopic ACTH may cause the Cushing syndrome. Another is the ACTH independent, that is the disease process lying in the adrenal gland. Adrenal tumor is the most common cause. And primary aldosteronism, we know what are the specialty of primary aldosteronism. Here the renin level will be less, and due to aldosterone escape there will be no edema. And adrenal, if it is happening due to adrenal adenoma, that is known as the Cone's disease. And in case of Cone's disease, there will be no edema due to aldosterone escape, which we can explain via atrial natriuretic peptide. Okay, otherwise it can be due to idiopathic adrenal hyperplasia or familial or hyperaldosteronism or adrenal carcinoma. Now Cone's disease, we know that excessive aldosterone secondary to adrenal tumor, they will retain sodium and excrete potassium, that will result in alkalosis. Hypertension is the universal sign of hyperaldosteronism, inability of kidneys to concentrate the urine, serum becomes concentrated, excessive thirst, hypokalemia interferes with the insulin secretion, but there will be no edema. Now, mineralocorticoid excess If it is due to secondary aldosteronism, that is maybe due to the congestive cardiac failure, the nephrosis, where due to first thing is due to hypovolemia, that will activate the renin-angiotensin system and that will activate the aldosterone. Okay, so in this case the renin level will be high and the edema will be there, except this Bartter syndrome. Deficiency of adrenocortical enzymes results in various syndromes. The congenital deficiency of the adrenal enzymes results in decreased cortisol secretion. Decreased level of cortisol in plasma stimulates ACTH secretion. Now, as the ACTH has growth promoting effect of the adrenal cortex, so the gland size will increase. That's why these conditions are known as congenital adrenal hyperplasia. So adrenal gland hyperplasia will be there due to the stimulating effect of ACTH. Now, deficiency of 21 beta hydroxylase and 11 beta hydroxylase are common. So this is 21 beta hydroxylase that converts the progesterone to 11 deoxycorticosterone, and 17 alpha hydroxyprogesterone to 11 deoxycortisone. So this specific 21 hydroxylase enzyme, its deficiency is common and it accounts for 90% of causes of congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Now, deficiency of 21 beta hydroxylase decreases production of glucocorticoids, we know that. So there will be less production of cortisol, glucocorticoids, as well as there will be less production of aldosterone or the mineralocorticoids. Decreased cortisol level in the plasma increases production of ACTH, which facilitates the production of pregnenolone from cholesterol. Now, spurious pregnenolone is diverted for the excess production of androgen. So, as this vertical axis, it is inhibited. So, most of the cholesterol, it will move into this horizontal axis, and more amount of dihydroepiandrosterone and androstenedione will be formed. Therefore, this condition is mainly characterized by virilization. Okay, so this leads to the characteristic adrenogenital syndrome in females. So in females, 21 beta hydroxylase deficiency will result in adrenogenital syndrome. The features of this syndrome will be hirsutism, small breast, heavy arms and legs, enlarged clitoris, and receding hairline. In severe cases, genitalia of genetic females are masculinized, that is, female pseudohypoparathyroidism will be there, and many of them develop hyponatremia, salt losing form, and hyponatremia occurs due to urinary loss of sodium, which occurs due to lack of mineralocorticoid activity, and hyponatremia causes hypovolemia and hypotension. So in case of 21 beta hydroxylase deficiency, there will be hyponatremia and hypotension. Now come to the next type of deficiency, that is the deficiency of this 11 beta hydroxylase that converts the corticosterone to the 18 hydroxycorticosterone, or which converts the 11 deoxycortisol to cortisol if this enzyme is deficient. So obviously, again, the vertical axis is inhibited, so they will move on to this horizontal axis and there will be increased production of androgen. Okay, and we know that there will be less production of mineralocorticoid as well as glucocorticoid. But one important point is that in case of 11 beta hydroxylase deficiency, in the zona glomerulosa we will find the 11 deoxycorticosterone level will be unaltered, because the block is beyond this 11 deoxycorticosterone. From 11 deoxycorticosterone, the corticosterone is formed. Okay, so block is here. Okay, so corticosterone production will be hampered, But up to 11-deoxycorticosterone, the production is okay. And this 11-deoxycorticosterone, if you remember, we have seen the relative potency of different actions. So we will see that this 11-deoxycorticosterone or corticosterone, they have a very good mineralocorticoid activity. So in absence of aldosterone, they can give some kind of mineralocorticoid activity. Okay, so there will be retention of sodium and water. Therefore, patients will develop hypertension in addition to virilization. So in 21 beta hydroxylase, there was virilization plus hypotension. But in 11 beta hydroxylase, that will be virilization plus hypertension. So hypertensive form of congenital virilizing adrenal hyperplasia. We can call it hypertensive form of congenital virilizing adrenal hyperplasia. In all virilizing forms of adrenal hyperplasia, glucocorticoid therapy is preferred. Exogenously administered glucocorticoid fills the endogenous cortisol deficit and also suppresses the production of ACTH. Now, as certain other milder type of deficiency, less common deficiencies are also seen. These are the deficiency of 17 alpha hydroxylase. Okay. So this 17 alpha hydroxylase, if this deficiency is there, it results in decrease in the production of sex steroids. Okay. So therefore, female external genitalia are present. However, as the production of aldosterone and corticosterone is normal, elevated level of mineralocorticoid results in hypertension and hyperkalemia. Another less common variety is the deficiency of this 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase. This is also a very rare condition. The production of dehydroepiandrosterone will be decreased. There is some degree of masculinization in female, but as dehydroepiandrosterone is a weak androgen, so it does not cause full masculinization. Okay, therefore hypospadias develops. Okay, now another type of deficiency is the cholesterol desmolase deficiency. Cholesterol desmolase, we know that this is a cholesterol desmolase deficiency. Of this decreases the production of all adrenocortical hormone because it converts cholesterol to progesterone. That is the first step of steroidogenesis. The condition is fatal during fetal life. The production of placental progesterone depends on the adrenal cortical production of androgen. So progesterone is essential for the pregnancy to continue. Thus, deficiency of this enzyme results in termination of pregnancy. However, this condition is very rare. Thank you.